The second in our two-part series, looking at GATT and NAFTA, with Mike Conroy, economics professor, who tells us about this amazing revolution in international capitalism. Who's going to benefit and who's going to be hurt? Right now on Alternative Views. In our last Alternative Views program, we dwelt at length with NAFTA, and particularly covering all the aspects of it that were not covered by the regular media. We were talking with Mike Conroy, who's an economics professor at the University of Texas at Austin, director of the Latin American Economic Studies Program, and he's the associate chairman of the economics department. This time, we're going to talk about the big daddy of GATT. I saw a statement somewhere that said, if you like NAFTA, you'll love GATT, because GATT, the General Agreement on Tariff and Trade, is something which could be even much more devastating than NAFTA. But before we have our interview, here are some news stories from the Alternative Press.
Well, in one of the biggest fraud cases in history, it was announced by the New York Times on October the 21st that Prudential agrees to pay investors for fraud losses at least $371 million, that 400,000 individuals were affected by this court decision. It appeared that Prudential Securities, which is a unit of Prudential Insurance Company of America, has been facing legal claims from people all over the country, investors, who said that the firm systematically cheated them in the sale of more than $800 billion of limited partnerships that invested in oil, gas, real estate, etc. Most of the investors were assured that these were safe, conservative, secure investments. In many cases, they weren't, and they were told of tremendously lucrative returns that would accrue from this investment that didn't materialize. Well, the Security Exchange Commission ruled that the advertisements or the claims that Prudential Securities made to its customers were simply fraudulent. They simply lied systematically all over the country and thus forced them to pay back investors millions of dollars for these fraudulent claims. They also charged the SEC widespread securities law violations at all 9 Prudential branch offices, failing to live up to terms of a 1986 settlement with the SEC on fraud charges, and severe legal and compliance problems with a whole lot of different issues.
I think it should be pointed out that this is not a fly-by-night organization we're talking about. Prudential is one of the core Rockefeller establishment financial institutions and has been for years and years and years. It always kind of galls me to see some of these big corporate executives saying, well, now all these bad things that you see about these capitalist corporations, those are just the smaller and medium-sized corporations. The big ones, we are good corporate citizens. We wouldn't stoop to that. Well, we found out what happens with Prudential. And Prudential also had it as chairman of the board, former chairman of the board, George Ball, who was one of the most significant men in the United States power structure and has been for years. You ever heard of Prucare? Well, that's Prudential Insurance. They're going to be one of the big recipients of the largesse of Clinton's health care program. And this, I guess, was only the second largest payout of because of fraud. The other one was Burnham Drexel Lambert. So you got to be careful whether it's a big company or a little company. You just can't say, well, we're an established old company. They'll rip your drawers off just as fast as some of the smaller companies.
If Bill and Hillary Clinton are serious about slashing U.S. health care costs expected to top $1 trillion by next year, they should re-examine Washington's love affair with the tobacco industry. Each year, smoking-related diseases are responsible for $21 billion in direct health care costs, according to the Congressional Office of Technology Assessment. Another $47 billion in unnecessary costs are due to lost productivity and lost earnings associated with smoking. Far from acting to curb these costs, let alone to slow a cigarette-related death toll of nearly 500,000 Americans per year, Congress has actively aided the tobacco industry. Capitol Hill has excluded cigarettes from the Consumer Product Safety Act and the Fair Labeling and Packaging Act. Lawmakers have also exempted tobacco from the Toxic Substances Act, even though a cigarette has more cyanide than was found in those tainted Chilean grapes that everyone was so worried about a few years back.
I saw an analysis of what was in cigarettes, and it was indicated that the cigarettes not only had benzene, but it also had DDT and phosgene. And phosgene, as people probably know, is nerve gas. So that actually when you're taking a big old long puff of that cancer stick, that you're actually inhaling this nerve gas and carrying out chemical warfare against your own body.
In the last few years, Congress has killed or simply ignored at least 10 anti-smoking legislative initiatives. The White House has been no better. Ronald Reagan and George Bush waged a costly war on drugs. This despite studies showing that illegal drugs were connected to the death of 19,096 Americans last year, 1/26th the number that were killed by cigarettes. And while the Reagan and Bush administrations were waging their war against drug pushers in Colombia, they were also actively pressuring other governments, especially in Asia, to open their markets to U.S. tobacco products. The new issue of World Smoking and Health, a publication of the American Cancer Society, looks at why the White House and Capitol Hill continue to guarantee tobacco's special place as the only mass-marketed consumer product that causes widespread death and disease when used as intended. The results are not surprising. The tobacco lobby has bought out our elected politicians, and the bribes are getting bigger. Industry contributions to incumbent U.S. senators through 1991 and the first half of 1992 were up 192% over the contributions made during all of the 1987-88 campaign cycle, according to one article. Will Clinton change things? Don't hold your breath. Several top White House advisors, including Mickey Cantor, the president's former campaign manager and current U.S. trade representative, have close ties to the tobacco industry.
In these times, in an earlier edition, said that they pumped $25.7 million into the campaigns of 1991 and 1992. And the largest amounts of this money went to the key members of the committees handling the health reform legislation. We'll have more news later.